I'm headed for a land that's far away, beside the crystal fountain. So come with me, we'll go and see the big rock candy mountains.
And we're back. This is the Great Classic Rock Debate. I'm Kenny.
I'm Paul with zero qualifications.
And I'm Steve.
And we talk anything and everything classic rock. We try to have fun. We try to keep it interesting. And that's what we do. We mix it up. If you're watching right now, please like, comment, and subscribe. Don't forget to check out our sister channel, The Great Classic Movie Debate. And let's get started. So, Paul, Steve and I were just talking to the whole idea, the idea of doing a show about our picks for Led Zeppelin or whatever. It's a great idea. I just don't want to do it tonight.
No, that's why I said another night.
Okay, yeah. I don't want to get into a thing. We did that with AC/DC and it was great. So we'll come back to that one. One of the things about us is we don't really have to have a topic because once we start, it just rolls. And I kind of like that. We've talked before about the spontaneity and it's not scripted or whatever. So I kind of like that. So I'm going to start with this. You guys have heard me talk many times in the past about both the Professor of Rock and Rick Beato. These guys make great videos. And the Professor of Rock, I mean, he gets up, I think, at least one video every day. And they're really good. He's not constrained by the topic of classic rock. I mean, we try to keep it on classic rock. He talks about anything related to music. I would say probably more than half of his fall under classic rock, but a lot of them don't also. But I forgot to mention this to you guys a few weeks ago. It might have even been a month ago. He did an entire episode on Norwegian Wood. Okay.
Oh, God.
And first of all, it was great. And secondly, I go, he's stealing our material.
But, as if we have material.
Yeah, exactly. But no, it's great. He tells this whole story or whatever. I mean, he knows the details better than I do. But here's where it gets good. The night that we talked about it, I know that I mentioned that there were different schools of thought on the ending of the song. The final line where it says, "So I lit a fire, isn't it good, Norwegian Wood?" There are some who said he burned her place to the ground.
Pyromaniac, you know? Yeah.
Yeah, he's a pyromaniac, exactly. So she left and he was angry because he didn't get sex or whatever and he burned her place to the ground. But the thing is, this is just me. I mean, I'm not inside John Lennon's head or anything, but she lived in it describes it as a room. She showed me her room. It's like a flat, what do they call it?
An
efficiency. Yes, like an efficiency apartment.
Studio.
Exactly. So you can't burn down her place without burning down the whole place, you know? You can't just selectively burn down her place and say, ha, ha, ha. So for me, that doesn't make sense. Maybe that was the intent, but for me, that doesn't make sense. He seemed, if the entire lyrical content of the song, there's no suggestion of anger or rage or anything like that.
No, I have the answer.
Go ahead. Tell me.
Originally, it says Norwegian is like three syllables. When John wrote it, he woke up one day with something in his pants and he goes, "Isn't this great English wood right here?" And then he goes, "That doesn't fit musically. Isn't that great Norwegian wood? It works.
I should have known that's where that was going. So,
you want a better story. There you go.
Well, it is a better story. You know, not necessarily true, but a better story. but anyway, I just thought it was great that he covered that song and explained the whole, you know, John Lennon was married at the time and it's based on a true encounter. He met this girl and went back to her place and didn't get anything, you know, so he wrote the song. So anyway,
on this topic, and we can set this for another show or maybe tonight, I want to talk about which bands have the best lyrics. Now I'm not talking about rhyming because rhyming is for idiots. But like the best imagery, and with some bands, you know, some bands like U2, they're, you know, they come out and tell you what this is all about, you know, and other bands, they dance around or they never say it and they use euphemisms, like "Who Will Stop the Rain," supposedly a metaphor for the Vietnam War.
Right.
That's what I've read.
I also told, on that note, I also told you that I had read that Bad Moon Rising, even though on the surface it's about a werewolf or whatever, but it was about Nixon getting elected. John Fogerty is a big liberal.
Yeah.
So he was enraged that that Nixon got elected. So, and I said, you know what? That makes sense. So, you know,
he's a liberal who made $100 million in capitalism, but yes, who's counting?
Yes, he did. Right, right. No, that Paul, that's a great topic because
Rage Against the Machine.
Lyrically, bands and rock artists, they're all over the place. I mean, some real, and Rush is a great example, really write intellectual lyrics with multi-syllabic words and you read it and you go, my God, who wrote this? This is genius.
Yeah.
And then others, I don't want to mention any names because I know that Steve is a big fan.
You mean
girls. Right.
It rhymes with Sotley Brew.
Right.
There's no mystery behind what their songs are about.
And that's fine.
Just like AC/DC. Exactly.
For the record, that's totally cool.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm not going to hear Motley Crue to hear, you know.
No, I agree. It is what it is.
You know.
So, but that's a great topic. But we'll do that another time. But I like that one. So tonight, for tonight, what I want to do is, I was thinking about this earlier this week. So every night I go to the gym. It's right around 8. When I leave, it's right around 9. And I got the classic rock station on, the one that I never stop complaining about.
There's no.
WKGR, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. The gamer.
And there's not another classic rock station. So if you're gonna,
oh, that's right. I stand corrected.
In this area, it's the only one. Yeah. So so they do this thing that they call the 90s at 9. All right.
Oh boy.
So yeah, and so let me explain as best I can what it is. They play about 5 or 6 songs, all from the 90s. All of them, I would put into the category of alternative rock. But none of them are songs that are part of their classic rock playlist. So they just do this little thing, the 90s at 9, in order to, I'm going to suppose, in order to get a little bit of variety into their predictable playlist.
You're right.
And then, and you know, some of the songs I think are decent, and other ones I go, yeah, it's not my favorite, whatever. But they're all from the 90s. They're all alternative. And they don't really fit with the classic rock format. So anyway, which brings me back to one of my never-ending complaints with classic rock as a whole, and that is they don't deep dive, or they don't look for those album tracks, the deep cuts, whatever. It's like, okay, their starting point is what was popular on the radio. That's where they start. And then of the songs that were popular on the radio, which ones can we play? And it just it annoys the crap out of me because there's so much good material within that decade or other decades too, but within the 90s. And the typical classic rock playlist, if we look at just what a classic rock station will play just from the 90s, not from the 60s or 70s and 80s, just from the 90s, it must only be 10 songs or less.
Yeah.
It's hardly anything.
I don't know how familiar you two are with Queens of the Stone Age, but they're awesome. They have a song on Songs for the Deaf. It's the very first song on the album, and it's set up. I mean, it's oddly set up just like Detroit Rock City. It's a guy flipping through the channels of radio stations. And the guy goes,
Yeah. Oh, you told me. Go say it again because this is a good little.
He goes, anecdote. That's right. I did say this. He goes, how's your drive by? How's your drive time? This is WKLN, Clone Radio. We play songs more like anyone else than everyone else.
Right.
And you're like, huh?
Right.
And the guy starts saying, I need a saga, man. I need a saga. And that's when that drummer, I forgot if that's Joey Castillo drumming on that album or not, but he just kicks in. It's one of their heaviest songs ever.
Right. I know, like, what song you're talking about. Yeah, whoa! I listen to it. Yeah.
Oh, my God. It's really good. So, but yeah. And so you're proving your point. Like,
so what I wanted to lead into, and I know that this is a topic that we've touched on or alluded to, but I want to do a little deeper dive. How did this happen? I mean, 1989 turned into 1990, turned into 1991. Last show, we talked about the amazing plethora of rock albums, which we can now, in retrospect, call classic rock albums that were released in 1991. It was this wealth of great music. And then by 92, something changed. And all of a sudden, radio steered. I mean, was it all attributed to Nirvana? I don't know. But rock radio steered away from, I guess, what we would consider sort of the mainstream classic rock sound, and went hard left for this alternative sound. Steve, and
yeah, because I'm going to go, yeah, but I want Steve to go.
I remember walking into high school when Nirvana, Smells Like Teen Spirit, when that video came out.
Yeah.
And a couple of people at school were talking about, they're like, oh, I really like this video. I was like, are you kidding me? Like, this is, like, I don't get it. I'm like, there's so much other better music out there. But ever since then, I don't know if it was because MTV really pushed it. And, you know, MTV back in the day, they used to play music videos for our younger audience out there.
Yeah, well, yes. Exactly. And they had a lot of influence in the music industry, period, especially rock. But, you know, yeah, over time, it was less about rock. But
so that's when I noticed a change, that everything was being pushed towards the alternative and kind of grunge. And there's some good bands in there. Nirvana, sure, again, not my thing. I like a couple of their songs, but
yeah, me too.
I really feel like it was MTV that really made the transition, and not necessarily the consumer. I think just MTV was just such an influencer and had the ability to push a band, or push the brand of a band.
Well, if you remember, and both of you, I need your help. When Use Your Illusion 1 and 2 came out, they had that song November Rain, which I absolutely hate. I think it's garbage.
Really?
Oh. I do not like that song.
You know,
but I'm the biggest Guns N' Roses fan. I just don't like, but.
You know, they originally tried to release that on Appetite.
Good. No, I was kidding.
Let's just say, it's interesting.
Just for the record, I think it's a masterpiece. I do. I really do.
It's probably my favorite or top two GNR song.
Oh, okay. My God. So anyway, but my point is, now, remember Terminator 2 came out. So they had You Could Be Mine was with Terminator 2.
Yes.
So it was pushed. That was being pushed. Remember, the radio stations the radio, whatever it was of 86 started monopolies of the radio stations. And remember, MTV, VH1, Viacom. And so, all right. So now, Steve, now the other, Civil War was released 6 months before that album came out.
Yeah, Civil War was the B-side, because I had the cassette single for If You Could Be Mine.
Civil
War was the B-side on that cassette single.
Because I remember hearing that.
Wow,
like,
not know that.
And I was with some people we're not going to talk about. And they were all like, they didn't like Guns N' Roses. So I was this close to killing all the people in the car. I said, the next person that talks during this song, I'm going to strangle you. And I'm not joking.
And I was going to say.
Go ahead, Steve.
Just one thing on Civil War. I'm pretty sure that that's the only song that Steven Adler, I think he actually drummed on that track. I think that's what I remember hearing. But everything else from those two albums is Matt Sorum.
Here's my question to you, Steve, and Kenny. So you had those two songs, You Could Be Mine, Civil War, and then you had November Rain. But those two albums have like a ton of really good songs. Not one of them played. Locomotive not on the radio.
Oh, Locomotive. Right. Oh, and that's awesome. That's actually in the set list, though.
But no, it's not on the radio. It was never played on that album. The Garden and Garden of Eden. Yep. And none of those songs were ever played on the radio. And I was enraged. And that one song has Alice Cooper in it.
Yep.
And that's your point, Kenny. Like, hold on. How did Guns N' Roses get jobbed here so we could hear Bryan Adams and this other garbage on classic rock?
Right.
And but yeah, Kenny, you're onto something. I don't know. Maybe an edict came down from the, you know.
Okay. Well, I know I've told this little anecdote before, but I'm going to throw it out as a reminder, because when I saw this and heard this, it was just a head scratcher. Like, what? You know, you guys, I sent you guys out a couple months back that list of the Classic Rock 2000, all of those songs. Somebody put a lot of time and effort into compiling that list. Well, one of the first times that I ever went through the list, I was very curious about their 90s choices. And of course, you've got this gigantic grouping of songs from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and then the list gets much shorter in the 90s. But there were two, not one, but two selections from 1994 by the Allman Brothers. And I'm going, what? There's the Allman Brothers were still recording in 1994. I didn't know this. This is around 2005. And so I actually went back and hunted down those songs and I played them. This was one of the biggest OMG moments probably of my life, because I went, okay, those two songs are as good as anything the Allman Brothers ever did. This is classic rock in its purest state. It's just great rock music, and it fits right into what made them.
Was one of them Soul Shine?
I think that was the album after.
Okay.
One of them, the name of the album is Back Where It All Began. And one of the songs is called Back Where It All Begins.
The other one
is called Nobody Left to Run With. They're both songs of guys who are like probably in their 40s, approaching 50. All right. Nobody Left to Run With. He's lyrically, he's complaining about the fact that all of his buddies are now married with kids. All of the guys he used to go out drinking and having a good time with are married with kids, and they can't do it. So he's by himself now. He's just got no one left to run with. And then the other song, Back Where It All Begins, it's just sort of alluding back to the roots of the band and how they first started out. I'm telling you, both of these songs are fantastic. And when I heard it and said, classic rock radio never played either one of those, something is, it's like the universe is out of sync or something. Why would you even be a classic rock station and then not play this when it's gifted to you on a silver platter? I don't get it.
Well, let me just interject here, because looking it up, Soul Shine was off of the Where It All Begins album.
Okay.
But right. I, as a kid, so I was 17 when that album, so 1994.
Correct.
They played it on the classic rock station where I grew up, and they played it so much that I thought it was one of their songs from the late 60s or early 70s.
Wow.
So that one song, Soul Shine.
Just that one song.
Okay.
Knocked down where Kenny and I are from, because we never.
Yeah, and it wasn't until a couple of years later that I realized, like, oh, this is one of their newer songs. I think it's because I found the CD in a store and bought it. And I was like, oh, okay, that makes sense.
I mean, did they have that, that song, Time of Your Life by Green Day, which makes me want to go to the mall with a machine gun and start firing on people.
Right. Yeah. And they, to this day, classic rock still plays that song as if, you talk about a head scratcher. Number one, it's not a rock song. Green Day does not fit. No matter how hard you try to force fit, they don't fit into a classic rock format. This is just another example of somebody saying, well, give me the list of songs that was popular, rock songs. Give me the list of rock songs that were popular in the 90s, and then I'll just handpick some and throw them onto the classic rock station. Has nothing to do with the quality of the song or whether it's properly being fit into that format. It's just awful.
I think you're on it. Because, like, Steve, like the Spaghetti Incident, did you ever hear any of those songs on the radio?
No.
No, and that's where I first heard Buick McCain.
Yeah. I heard it on Soundgarden does a version of it on their first album.
No, they did release one. They had a music video for Since I Don't Have You.
Okay.
So that,
you know, what? I think so. I think you're right.
But not on classic rock. I never heard it.
I don't know
it.
If they played it on classic rock, but I remember.
No, they did not. No, they didn't.
But there's a lot of great covers on that, on the Spaghetti Incident.
Oh my God. It's awesome. Yeah. That's a man that I think I like that one. I like Metallica's covers too. That's a good, that's a really good cover album they do.
The local classic rock station here plays Metallica's Turn the Page. It's fantastic.
I think it's fantastic. Steve will disagree, but I think it's better than the original. But that's
just disagree.
Me. Oh, okay.
You're not going to hear a disagreement from me with Metallica.
Okay, no.
I'm not going to go that far. Better than the original, I'm not going to go that far, but man, it's up there.
And
it's
their whiskey, whiskey in the jar, Thin Lizzy's. Oh, yeah. Jeez.
Astronomy on that record is, I think, a million times better than the original, than Blue Oyster Cult's version. And Blue Oyster Cult has a good version of it, but I really love the Metallica version on that.
Hold it. On that album, did they recover their cover of Am I Evil, right? They recovered their cover?
Am I Evil was done by... Am I Evil was not there.
Yeah, Diamond Head. I know, they covered... Head. No, I know, they did that...
Yeah, I always get confused. I'm like, you're right, Paul. I think they did
recover. They recovered their cover. Because I mean, this sound—you can just tell by the quality of the engineering and the sound quality is much better.
Yes.
Okay.
Like if you hear Diamond Head, it's great, but it's so. This is what Steve and I kind of disagree. It sounds muffled, like Led Zeppelin at the time. Led Zeppelin's recording is the best equipment on earth.
Right. I love the I love the album. The sounds of recordings from the '70s. I don't from the '80s, especially the early '80s.
Well, you know, that was all because they were making the transition to digital and they were trying to hype up too much shit stuff.
Well, and it's also possible maybe the songs that I've listened to during the 70s have now been remastered or were remastered, because when I really got into Led Zeppelin, this would have been like the early 90s, they were just remastering all of their stuff.
Yeah.
Jimmy Page was. So maybe that's why I think that the sound from the 70s is great, but
maybe I'm deaf. I don't hear that much difference between the remastered Zeppelin and the original Zeppelin, but that's just me. Maybe I'm just deaf. But like when you hear, you know, I don't know, I'm trying to think of an album. It's just a normal album play today. You're like, oh my God, this is 1,000 times better.
But well, I agree for the most part. I mean, the Garage Days album, I think, is one of the best sounding albums.
Oh, couldn't agree more.
Yeah.
The sound of that album is phenomenal. It's a top 5 sound design of an album.
Yeah, like if you hear Hero of the Day, is that right?
Hero of the Day.
Oh, that song is just, if you play it out loud, it's just like, it's perfect. You know what I'm saying? Like the way it's drummed, the sound, I mean, the guitars, it's just.
Yeah, Metallica, I think, cut a lot of flack from their traditional fans from the stuff they released in the 90s. In fact, I know they did. But those three albums, Load and Reload, and then the Black Album, are like, I challenge anybody to find a better three.
Yeah, I agree. Those are really good. And it bothers me that, again, classic rock radio, other than the remake, the cover of Turn the Page, I don't think they play anything else from those albums. By the way, Steve, quick question. You've talked before about your it's a satellite classic rock station.
Yeah, Sirius XM. Yeah.
Okay. And do they play what is known as deep cuts?
They do. In fact, they have a whole channel called Deep Tracks.
Yeah.
My God.
That's awesome.
That is one of the greatest listening experiences, because you can be listening to music that might be 40 or 50 years old, but it's brand new to you.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
I've never heard this before.
Yeah.
And why stations, it should be automatic to do this.
Yeah, but that's what, occasionally they'll play a deep track on their main classic rock station is Classic Vinyl. And then they have one that's Classic Rewind, that's kind of late 70s, early 80s. Okay. And occasionally you'll hear a deep track on that, but yeah, Deep Tracks is phenomenal. And yeah, you hear stuff all the time. You're like, this is brand new to me, but it was recorded 40 years ago.
That's right.
Exactly. Or I mean, sometimes it'll be a song and I'll go, oh my God, I haven't heard that since 1973. I forgot it ever existed. And it's like hearing it for the first time.
Yeah.
Amazing.
The ELO, Last Train to London, I just heard it the other day. I hadn't heard that song in like 20, I'm gonna start crying a little bit. because it was bringing back memories of like, I think it, when did that come out, in the 79? I can't remember.
I'm going to say 79.
Yeah. I was having like high school and Auburn flashbacks because I hadn't heard that song in so long. It just, it was just like crushed me. They never played that on the radio. I had to find that myself.
The only songs that I hear from ELO played on the radio are Don't Bring Me Down
and Evil Woman.
And Evil Woman.
Yeah, that's probably it. Because those two are a little, they have a little harder edge. Most of ELO stuff falls a little more in the pop category than rock. They were gifted songwriters, though. My God. Really great songs. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And
another.
One of my favorite singers of all time. I just love his voice. I love his stuff with the Traveling Wilburys, with him, especially him and George Harrison.
I just love, and I'm a sucker for Ludwig drums, and you could hear that deep bass on ELO like Bonham does. There's no other drums sound like that, and I think most other drums are garbage, but that's just my opinion. Ludwig, all the way, baby. Steve, I threw you a softball. I was waiting for you to hit it.
No, I played Tama.
Tama's awesome. Neil Peart used to play those.
And I know you don't like Drum Workshop, DW.
No, God.
But they make the best hardware.
They sound like if I was farting, that's what those drums sound like to me.
No, they're great. It's kind of like when you sit down at a DW or a Drum Workshop kit, it's like you sat into a Ferrari. It's the feeling of everything. It's just
the feeling.
It's kind of like when you play a Les Paul for the first time, you're like, okay, now I know what I've been missing is that now I feel like I'm driving a Corvette.
Yeah, I just
or man. A Formula One car.
It drove me nuts because I went to see Jason Bonham's Led Zeppelin experience. He plays the whole concert on the Ludwigs, and then after like later on, he'll play some of his own songs on his Drum Workshop. And I'm like, stop with that garbage. Go back to the Ludwigs. And I was sitting like sixth row, and the bass of the Ludwigs aiming right at me. So I was in heaven. Just keep pounding that bass drum like your dad.
And you're gonna tell Jason Bonham what kind of drum kit he should play.
Yes, because his dad played. Hey, you're the one that talks about his kicking on the bass drum. So, John Bonham.
Yeah.
All right, guys, listen. We got our warning.
Oh, sorry.
No, it's okay. It's okay. So we're going to go ahead and wrap it up. You know, I wanted to mention something really quick. I meant to mention it earlier and I forgot. This was another one of the things that I watched on one of the Professor of Rock videos. The song Don't Stop Believing, which, by the way, I heard on my way home from the gym tonight. You know, that song still sounds good after all these years. It turns out that the guitar solo, which is, it's not a long solo. It's fairly short, but it's awesome. I mean, Neil Sean. Anything he does, okay. But I don't know who, the record executives or whoever wanted that removed. They were like, no, that makes the song too hard. Huh. It's a catchy pop song. You don't want to put that in there. And they fought about it. And Journey was relentless. Nope, that guitar solo is going in there. And so
it's part of the song. I mean, that's the stupidest thing.
Yeah. And it's just so good that song would suck without it. It'd be a game changer.
It's like that band Autograph. They had that song,
Turn Up the Radio.
The records, because they didn't want it on the album. They like, okay, we're walking out of here. And they had to fight tooth and nail to get that out. And that's, of course, it's their major. And only
right. Thing, can anybody name another song from them?
Exactly.
No. Okay.
That's a anybody? Great song.
Does anybody have nominations to our classic rock playlist? Songs that they should be playing, but they're not.
Go ahead, Steve.
Well, since we were talking about Guns N' Roses, I'll put on Estranged, which is probably my favorite Guns N' Roses song. It's epic. It goes through a whole progression where it starts off really, really slow. You bring in I think there's an orchestra in there. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head, but it just, it's a really good song. I at first I didn't like it.
Okay. That song was off of
Use Your Illusion 2.
Okay. All right.
Yep. It's about a 9-minute song. So,
right. They had several really long songs on those two albums.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to echo what I said earlier about, I think that, November Rain is an absolute masterpiece. Okay. I do. Okay, so my nomination, you know, we've talked before about how 70s and 80s style classic rock still remains a big thing in a lot of European countries, even though over here it's, you have to listen to oldie stations to hear it, but over there the bands, a lot of them, they're trying to sound like Guns N' Roses and other popular classic rock bands. Okay, so there's one in particular. They use, I think it's Sweden. They use the acronym DAD, but their name is not DAD. They're DAD, but that actually stands for Disneyland After Dark. I have no idea of the origin of that name. I don't know why they named themselves that, Disneyland After Dark, but I just say DAD. And they had a song from the year 2000 called Everything Glows. And it's never been played. I mean, I'm confident no one's ever heard it, whatever. But if you pull it up and give it a listen, it's a good hard rock song. It fits right into the mold of what they're trying to accomplish as far as the 70s and 80s hard rock, classic rock sound. So DAD, Everything Glows.
All right, I'm back to GNR called Sorry. It's on the Chinese Democracy album. Oh my God, I'm not sorry for you. I'm sorry for Oh my God,
it's a great song.
And that album, what it happens with that album is every year I add a song on there that turns out to be pretty damn good. At first it was like two or three songs, and then one time Kenny and I were going to Auburn football game, and I put on If the World, and I'm singing along. And Kenny's like, "Who is this?" I go, "This is Guns N' Roses." You're like, "No, it isn't." "Yes, it is." And he's like,
"It's Axl Rose." I love the album, Chinese.
I know. Oh, here it comes. Go ahead.
It's not a Guns N' Roses album.
Hey, Bumblefoot and Buckethead are on there. They're good. I love both those guys.
Nobody's paying $300 to see those guys. And they're great musicians. Don't get me wrong. It's not a knock against them. But when you think of Guns N' Roses, that's not.
I know. I love Slash. I met him real life. He's a super cool guy. I'm just saying, you know, they had their party and then they're back together. But Bumblefoot and Buckethead,
they're great. Number one.
Okay. You guys can arm wrestle over that to see who's right. So we're gonna go ahead and wrap it up for now.
We did. Steve won.
For now, this is the Great Classic Rock Debate. I'm Kenny.
I'm Paul.
I'm Steve.
And if you're watching right now, please like, comment, and subscribe. Don't forget to check out our sister channel, The Great Classic Movie Debate. Until we meet again, we'll see you next time.
Laters.
Thank you.